Hi, this is Angela Valencia Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. Today we're at the home slash gallery slash amazing work of Joe Novak. We're going to talk to him, learn about his life as an artist, and maybe if we're lucky, a little bit of the life before the artist. But it's all one and the same.
I think we all have it within us. Oh, you think I know? I mean, come on.
Well, you can thank it. Come on, we've got an interview.
I know, but I'm not going to. I know we do.
Come along with us, and we'll take you over to the world of Joe.
Welcome to Colliding Worlds. I'm your host, Angela Valenti Romeo. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
We're with Joe Novak. Thank you so much for being with us.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here. It really is.
I'm going to ask you the million-dollar question.
A million dollars, wow.
You left a thriving career as an attorney.
Right.
Went right brain, left brain, left brain, right brain, became an artist.
Right.
Why? And did people think you were insane?
Of course there were people who thought I was nuts to leave the law because I was successful in that practice. When I left the law, I didn't know I was going to be an artist. It's something that happened a number of years later. As a youngster, I painted a little bit and had an interest in art. And when it was supposed to explode, it did. And it was sort of a serendipitous beginning. I didn't even know that I had entered the world of being an artist until I was down the pathway, and then suddenly I said to myself one day, I think I'm an artist because all I want to do is paint. During my years practicing law, mostly in Puerto Rico, I was friendly with a lot of artists and collected their work and was sort of part of that world, but I was on the other side. I never saw myself as being one of them, but I saw myself as of their world. When I got to the point where I self-acknowledged, that's when the fast forward started. But before that, I didn't see myself, you know, as that. I saw the artists as those people, not me. I had my first showing actually in East Hampton, New York, 1985 at the Verrid Gallery. And that happened after I had put a painting in a juried show at the Parish Art Museum the previous year, 84. And out of a large number of entrants, mine got in. And that sort of kicked off my career. And living in the Hamptons, I came in contact with quite a few people from the New York art world, people who had been around during the years that abstract expressionism was taking root. And my principal mentor was Peter Busa, who was a close friend of Pollock and de Kooning and those people. And he was only alive for a couple of years when I lived there, but he made an enormous difference. And in fact, ahead of us, where we're sitting now, is a painting that was sort of my breakthrough painting called Just Red that he had a lot to do with. But it's sort of a long story, and it's just that his intervention at the right moment stopped me from going further, and that's made a big difference.
Now, your work involves lots of color.
Correct.
And it's not just color that comes out at you in neon, it's color that comes out at you in blocks, but it's very subtle.
Yeah.
And even in the larger pieces which we're going to show, like Just Red, it's not just red. There's more to this than that. What drew you to this whole idea of color?
Well, I think when I acknowledged to myself that I was an artist, color somehow was an avenue I wanted to pursue. I think perhaps one of the reasons is that there were so many artists who worked with color, whose work I was really drawn to. Artists like Kandinsky, the Delaunays, more contemporary artists like Helen Frankenthaler, Mark Rothko. Mm-hmm. As an artist, I have felt that I have been channeling. And when my work turns out well, I definitely feel like I've channeled it. I haven't done it.
You also were involved with printmaking for a while.
Yes.
And that's...
Printmaking is something I was very drawn to. I love the collaborative aspect of it. I worked for a couple of summers at Crown Point Press in San Francisco, made plates, have done a lot of Aquitaine etchings, and I worked with master printers in Santa Fe. One of the wonderful things about printmaking is when you put the paper through the press in the kind of thing I was doing, you never knew what you were going to get until you picked the paper up. And these are multi-plate etchings, so that means the paper goes through the press multiple times. Mm-hmm. And I asked Mike Costello, with whom I did a lot of printmaking at Hand Graphics in Santa Fe, if he had ever had an experience where he knew what was going to come out of the press. And his answer was, never.
With painting, because you are channeling, do you ever sit there and just look at this canvas and go, okay, brush, okay, hand, where? Or, you know, is there some kind of that moment where you sit there and you go,
You're talking mm-hmm. about the process of mm-hmm. painting, not when it's finished. Well, there are times when you're with it, there are times when you're not with it. The times when you're with it, it's not such a struggle and an effort, and when you're not with it, it is. And it's sort of just letting go and just having a sense of authority as you proceed. And then ultimately, the eye will tell you what's there. Because the big question often is with works of art, when is it finished? Mm-hmm. Well, that's an important part. But so the eye is a very big part of it, but not just the eye, it's all a lot of hard work.
Well, your work is large scale. Yeah. There's a lot of larger pieces. Some artists work from studies. Are you able to work from a study on this, especially
on that
scale?
I've tried working from a study. It didn't work for me. I need to be, you know, spontaneous. It's just works that way.
The one thing that drives me out of my mind is when you hear someone going, it's just paint. and the skill and the process of this whole thing is lost on them. It's kind of, to me, it's a little frustrating because I know it's not so haphazard. Have you heard that about your work, where they go, oh, it's just
color? Well, I mean, it's almost as if you were reading my mind, because my breakthrough painting, which I'm staring at now, which is about, I don't know, 7 feet by 9 feet, called yeah. Just Red, I did that in East Hampton, and when my mother was visiting, and when she saw it for the first time, she looked at it, and she said, it's just paint. Of course, the way she saw art was it had to be some kind of recognizable object, because that's, you know, where she was coming from. Her sister, who was with her, said, oh, it looks like a velvet wall. Well, that, you know, showed a little bit of imagination. You know, I always say about what one gets from this, what you see is what you get. So she saw paint, that's what she got. But over the years, she changed. And before she passed away in 2002, I was having a retrospective at the Hood Museum at Dartmouth College, and there was a catalog that they had produced, and my mother got to see the catalog. And in my last visit with her, a friend was visiting her, and she had Parkinson's, she couldn't move, and she was in her mid-90s. And the friend knocked on the door. She says, come in. There's a great artist here who I want you to meet. And so she has sort of come around. But maybe a lot of it was the fact that I had some recognition then. And that always helps to cause people to see things a little differently.
And you started in the 80s.
1981. I even know the exact date.
I find
it was
that's
June 14, 1981, when by chance I had a visitor and lived in, had a house in Far Island, and picked up a paintbrush and was invited to do a watercolor by an artist who was visiting me for the weekend and was doing one as a house gift. And that was when it started.
These are the jewelry stylings of Angela Valente Romeo, upcycled adornment, with purpose, meaningful, provocative art. Each piece individually crafted, combining past, present and future to tell its own story. Visit us at www.theonlyonejewels.com.
First gallery show, not East Hampton, which was part of a jury show, but your own first time where the gallery is just featuring all of your work. What kind of thought process?
Yeah, that was in 1987, and that was a show in East Hampton at Ashwaug Hall, but sponsored by my gallery. And an amazing thing happened. That show was up for, I don't know, you know, maybe there were 500 people in the whole world who saw that show. And that was in May of 1987. And in October of that year, I was in Paris and I took a trip to Giverny. I'd never gone to see Monet's gardens and studio. And I went with a group on a bus. And at the end of that little tour, I was sitting in the large studio where he had done the water lilies, and thinking of Monet, and a stranger approached me and said, "Are you Joe Novak?" And I was somewhat shocked. Yeah, I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, I just wanted you to know that I saw your show at Ashwaug Hall in May and how wonderful the show was." And I took that as a sign that connected me in a way to Monet. And I'm not comparing myself to Monet, but in another way, as a creative person, I am. And it was, I mean, I even saw that as, now I know why I went to France on this trip.
What I loved about Monet towards the end of his life, when he was going blind, was basically painting color.
Yeah, and he was quite abstract at the end, too, and I love those late paintings.
When you're working on these projects, on any given piece of this size, are you working months, weeks, years? Are you a rapid
painter?
It's
hard to say. You know, it's sometimes they go fast, sometimes they don't. It could be months, it could be weeks, it could be days, but that's not too often with the large ones. And I worked on these large paintings on horses and flat, and so they were like tabletops. I had long brushes, work wet into wet on unprimed cotton duck.
Do you do your own stretching?
I did my own stretching. I had assistants from time to time to help me stretch, but they never stretched it the way I wanted it to be. So I'd go back and re-stretch. So I decided, no, I'll do it myself.
Have you ever considered sculpture?
I haven't done sculpture myself, but I'm very drawn to minerals, and I collect them, and I started in 2002, actually going to the mineral shows in Tucson, and I wanted to incorporate minerals into my work in some way. I didn't know how I'd do it. So I started by buying minerals, and ultimately I produced a series of 50, I call them painting assemblages, assemblage. And they're sort of boxes, the surface of which is a painting, and then there's a niche with a mineral floating, and the mineral and the painting are somehow symbiotic. It just worked that way.
It's
so I call the series Echoes, and you've seen a couple of them.
Yeah. Is there that one piece that you've created or maybe have yet to create that is so intensely personal, it draws into all of these things that you couldn't part with it, or?
Well, there's one that I parted with, and it was the very last large painting that I did. I named it for my father. It's called Ben, was his name. And the piece was completed on what would have been his 100th birthday. And you see, I don't believe in coincidences, and there are so many things like that have happened in my career where things somehow work together in a way that, you know, you couldn't plan. It just happened. I think it's in Park City, Utah now, but I parted with it because I knew it needed to go out. And that painting went to a private collector. Another one is in the Art Museum of New Mexico. As much as I like color, the grays and darks, you know, blacks and whites can be powerful too. I'm going back just before you came today. I was on the phone talking to a person who heads the art program at the University of New Mexico Health Sciences Center, and they're doing a retrospective of some of the pieces that they have of mine in July. We were just talking about setting that up. And so I'm going back to Santa Fe in July. And so I've always gone back to places where I've lived and sort of reconnected. And I have so many friends in so many places that it's nice to actually see them, you know, in real time.
Yeah.
Versus
Skype.
Versus Facebook and whatever.
Where are you going next, other than back to Santa Fe?
Oh, you think I know? I mean, come on.
Well, you can fake it. Come on, we've got an interview.
I know, but I'm not going to. I know we do, but I'm.
the works that I've seen recently at Archdeacon Gallery are much, much smaller.
Yes, they're small. They're sort of miniatures of the large paintings in a way. They're all about color as well. But in terms of where I'm going, where are you going? Well, you probably have your next several interviews lined up.
No, we just sort of go with the flow.
Well, that's what I do too, you know? And I think that's the best way. I had my teeth cleaned the other day, and the dental hygienist said to me, well, what are your plans for the rest of the day? And I said, I think I'm just going to let it unfold. And she said, oh, I love that. And she said, you know, I even feel like it's taking pressure off of me. So basically, there's your answer.
I think it's been really kind of an interesting evolution that you embarked on this career, and in a short space of time, you've made a mark in the art world, and you continue to make a mark in the art world.
Well,
and that's something I think
the major thing for me has been the quality of my life experience, the life that I have lived through having this to be involved in, the people that I have met, the total experience. It's been, you know, such an enhancer of the quality of my life. And then there's the art.
That's just the icing on the cake.
Which is there.
I think it's been an interesting journey to learn about.
Yeah.
We're going to show you some of the artwork that's here. We're going to show you how to find it on the web. We're going to tell you about going to Santa Fe. Maybe you can see it firsthand.
Yeah. I show there at Zane Bennett Contemporary Art in Santa Fe.
We're going to give you website addresses. We're going to give you some info, and you can all take your own little journeys. And it's been worth it. And this has been an incredible afternoon. Thank you so much.
I've loved it. I've really loved it. Thank you.
Take care. This has been Colliding Worlds, and I hope you're walking away with something really special today. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Nina Puccillo. Would you like to learn how to cook gorgeous gourmet meals with innovative recipes that are gluten-free, low glycemic, heart healthy, delicious, and nutrient dense? Then check out my cookbook on ninacucina.com.
In the last 14 months, I've dropped 25 pounds. It's with these wonderful recipes out of the Nina Cucina cookbook.
It will give you everything that you need to get healthy today.
Hi, this is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds, and it's coffee time. No, we're going to be talking to Brian Wilson. We're going to learn about his art, what brought him to this. We're going to show you some really interesting things, and we're going to learn a little bit about this man. So come along with us as we take you on another adventure with coffee. Hi, I'm with Brian Wilson. We're going to hear all about his work. Thank you for being with us.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
I'm looking at some really magnificent things. Explain to me why you chose this profession.
a reason.
Pick it up.
It's a heck of a question. Now, you know, art for me has been something that started since I was a child. I was drawing. I was an only child. So I spent a lot of time keeping myself busy. So part of that was just a lot of drawing. So it wasn't getting into painting and so forth until I was probably my early to mid 30s, and I was doing real estate. I closed some deals, and I had just sort of some time finally, and I thought, you know, I'm gonna actually go back to my roots. It was time for some artwork, so I collected my paint and started, and it's just been a progression of trying to build on my life and somehow, you know, pull my experiences into my artwork. And a lot of my concentrations have been sort of an abstract landscape. This is kind of evidence.
And they've got a lot of texture to them. Mm-hmm. And that's done through the building up of the paint. So are you painting primarily in acrylic or oil?
Mostly acrylic. I have very little oil work. So it's mostly acrylic and a lot of other substrates. You know, like this is built up with sand, and we've got, you know, grains of sand and modeling paste and paint and gesso and other mediums that I'm working with that are mixed in with the paint to create the texture.
Are you drawn more to the texture of the paint? It seems all of these paintings, they're not flat.
No.
They're very much a three-dimensional, almost sculptural-like.
Yeah. I you know, my current drive has been sort of playing with, you know, sort of pulling color together in with texture and finding, you know, unique ways to combine the two. I have a lot of work that's done with the colors and, you know, very smooth, and you've got all these different very abstract kind of designs and colors and mixtures going on. And what I'm trying to do is kind of marry that color scheme with some of my more textural stuff, which really makes me sort of feel like I'm connecting in with my experience with the, you know, with nature and the outdoors and so forth. So finding that balance between, you know, color, you know, this by itself, you know, some of my images from, you know, I've had a lot of fun creating. It's sort of a challenge for me to match those up, those styles up with this heavy texture base that, you know, has relief coming out, that's built, you know, instead of on canvas, it's built on, you know, wood or wood-like substance, and marrying it together. And somehow, you know, almost every one of my pieces have been motivated by a place I visited or an experience I've had in some way. So trying to sort of blend the feeling of that with the color and the texture.
Very much influenced by your environment and your surroundings.
Very much, yeah.
You hike a lot.
A lot. Well, not as much as I'd like, but I'm in the outdoors a lot. I enjoy it a lot, so when I go, it has impact. Artwork for me has been exploration. So, you know, every piece that I start, I try somehow, even if it's just something really minor, maybe even the viewer may not even understand or pick up on, but I try something new with each of my paintings. And this technique is something that I've been sort of drawn to because I love the outdoors.
You're new to the art scene. You're new to a lot of things, and it takes lots of guts to take something that you've created and toss it out to the public.
Yeah, it does.
And you've done several shows. Mm-hmm. And how did that feel? I mean, it's kind of like, it's nice when you're in your cocoon in your studio.
Correct.
And there's a whole different ball game where people are like, oh.
Yeah. Yeah, and all of a sudden somebody walks in and has comments about it. You know, I've The very first time I had stuff up publicly was a sort of a small, it was a benefit and also an exhibition for myself. And many of the people that were there had no idea who I was because of the event. It was co-hosted with somebody else. And it was fun because I could kind of walk through the room and watch and listen. And many of the people had no idea that I was the artist. So it was just, that's when you just take a deep breath and say, well, you know, I've created it. You have no control over what the reaction's going to be. And it was fascinating for me because I was actually interested in it. And yeah. I didn't mind the you know, because I the only way I can look at it is I'm as myself with my own appreciation of art. I know that there's certain pieces that I'm drawn to and there are certain pieces I'm not as drawn to. And everyone's going to be that way regardless of my work. I'm no different than anybody else that way. So I use that same thought process in
I'm
having
always
that
fascinated.
Knowledge and getting out there. And
well,
not,
you created the work and somebody stands behind you and looks at it over your shoulder and says, oh, I see.
Yeah, whatever, yeah.
I see little cherubins walking around. You're like, really? Did you get that kind of like reaction that you didn't expect? Like, you see what? You
know? I was fascinated with it. I'm fascinated, you know, as much as I concentrate on a lot of these paintings and the color and the feeling and the places, you know, at the end of the day, it's the humanity of all of it that actually fascinates me, the why, and not just my why, you know, my question of something and an answer, but what stimulates somebody else.
I've noticed some common factors with people we've interviewed, and it's the glint in the eye.
It's
like,
in the eye,
this
it away.
Is it, you know, you can't hide it. You just can't hide it.
Yeah.
Now, because you're new to the scene, tell us where we can find your work. Will you have a website?
I do have a website.
And we'll tell everybody where that is.
It's Brian Wilson, brianwilsonart.blogspot.com. So
we'll definitely give it to you.
That's a mouthful. So you can find the work there. And there's no shows currently planned at this point. I just finished one here in town at Espresso Cielo. But hopefully that'll change quickly. So
you never know. I mean, the art world
change.
Is, and now the art business has said that Palm Springs is one of the most inspiring, 10 most inspiring cities for art.
Oh, I hadn't read that yet. So
here we are.
I feel great about that. I'm right in one of the vortexes.
There you go. I am so proud to have met you.
Thank you.
I have enjoyed your company. I am happy to see that you've found a spot in the world that makes you happy. The work is really interesting. I love the texture to it.
Thanks.
I like the inspiration from it. And don't let him fool you. He may be a newbie at this, but there's a talent and skill here. Thank you so much
Thank
for being
you.
With us.
Thank you.
And we're gonna let everybody know where to find Brian. Thanks. Again, this has been Angela Valente-Romeo. This has been Colliding World, and we hope you found a new little world, or a little piece of it anyway. Till next time.